In this macro photography tutorial, we're going to be creating macro time-lapse videos of growing ice crystals on paintbrush bristles and also on a candle wick. I'll explain in just a sec. Hi guys, I'm Ben from AdaptLux, and today I've got another very sciencey video for you. This is probably not something that you're going to have around your home, similar to how we had to order in some ferrofluid. We've got our hands on a very interesting chemical that grows ice for us on demand. This is dichloromethane. It's a solvent, and I'm going to give you some warning advice in just a minute, but Sam used this stuff a long time ago to create ice crystals on the end of a paintbrush back when the AdaptLux Studio was still in prototype version. I want to recreate that and maybe take it a little bit further as well. Before we jump into the photography, I do need to give you a little warning about dichloromethane. It's a solvent and it is very irritant. If you get it on your hands, it can irritate your skin. If you get it in your eyes, ingest it or breathe it in, it can do you some damage. Make sure you're wearing the right protective clothing, including gloves, glasses, and in a nice ventilated room so that you don't breathe too much of this stuff in. I have had it on my hands and it didn't cause me any irritation, but you might have more sensitive skin than I, so take any precautions you think are necessary and make sure to read the warning labels. Now that the safety briefing is over, let's take a look at this stuff and exactly what it does when we put it onto a paintbrush. Now, I'm not a chemist, I'm trying to remember all of my high school science, so if there are any chemists down in the comments, do correct any of my reasoning of why any of this is happening. Dichloromethane is not a particularly interesting chemical in its normal properties. So it's a solvent, it dissolves certain plastics, and we use it to adhere those plastics together. What we're looking at today, though, is not its primary use. We're looking at the side effect that it causes because it's so volatile. Now, what I mean by volatile is not explosive or anything like that. It just evaporates really easily, even at room temperature. As it evaporates, it takes a lot of the surrounding heat with it. So what we're going to be doing is saturating a little paintbrush like this, and as the dichloromethane evaporates from the bristles of the brush, it's going to cool it down really, really quickly and really, really far, so that the surrounding moisture in the air is actually going to freeze into growing crystals on the bristles of the brush. They'll only last maybe a few seconds, maybe a couple of minutes if you're lucky, but that's long enough for us to get some really cool time-lapse videos of the crystals growing and then melting away again. Now, enough explanation, let me show you exactly what happens when I dip my paintbrush into the dichloromethane. You're going to want to have your camera and your lighting already set up before you put your dichloromethane onto your brush. That's because it's going to freeze really quickly, and you want to have all of your focus set and your lighting adjusted before that starts to happen, or you're going to miss the start of it. So my lighting setup, I have the AdaptLux Studio here with a single white lighting arm plugged in and a diffuser on the end of the arm. This means that I can adjust my lighting really easily, move it all the way around my brush, and try and find the best lighting for where these crystals are actually going to grow. They're a little bit tricky to light because they are so pure white, but if we can get close enough and we can experiment with our lighting, I think that we can get some really cool time-lapse videos from this subject. Speaking of getting very close, we do have to get extremely close for this type of shoot. I have done a few shots on my 100mm lens, but I've changed over to this reverse lens setup so that we can get even closer. What I've got here is a 50mm prime lens reversed onto some extension tubes, which are then attached to my camera. go and check out some of our other videos, which I'll link up in the top corner, which explain how to do this reverse lens setup in a little bit more detail. Suffice to say, this gets us plenty close to be able to see each individual bristle on our brush as it freezes. If you don't want to be dipping your paintbrush into your dichloromethane, there is another option. So I have my camera set up here with my paintbrush in place and a couple of lighting arms with a couple of diffusers ready. I'm actually going to use a pipette dropper to grab just a little bit of dichloromethane and pop it straight onto the bristles of my brush. You can see that as I saturated the bristles of the brush, there is quite a lot of that dichloromethane to evaporate, and it's going to make it nice and cold. You can see it freezing in real time and those ice crystals growing from the moisture in the air. It seems to me like the more dichloromethane there is to evaporate and the colder you can get your brush, the more of these ice crystals you're actually going to create and the longer the effect lasts before it very quickly melts again. I started out dipping my brush into my dichloromethane and trying to place it in my clamp as quickly as possible, but I do think that using that pipette dropper is probably the easiest and best way to go about this. It means that you can have your brush set up in your clamp, everything focused and lit properly before you even start freezing anything. It also negates the side effect of diluting your dichloromethane, because once you've frozen your brush and it's then thawed again, you're going to have a little bit of water in that brush. Dipping it back into your dichloromethane bottle is going to dilute your dichloromethane. So definitely, if you've got a pipette dropper or a water dropper of some sort, try using that. If it's made of plastic, make sure it's not susceptible to the solvent qualities of dichloromethane, though. You don't want to go about melting your pipette dropper. I do have another idea for this, and I'm calling it the frost candle. With that idea that the more dichloromethane that you can actually evaporate at once and the more you can saturate your brush, I was thinking, what would happen if we had almost an unlimited supply of dichloromethane to evaporate? And that's where I started thinking about candles. This is an oil lamp. Traditionally, you'd fill it with some flammable oil, and that oil burns on the wick to create a flame. What I'm going to use it for, though, is a dichloromethane reservoir, a frost candle, if you like. I'm going to remove the little decorative glass casing around the edge, and then we basically have a big reservoir that we can put some dichloromethane in. We have this wick, which will become saturated, just like our paintbrush, and we have these little bristles on the top that can grow some frost for us. I think this is going to create much bigger crystals that'll last for a lot longer. So I'm going to give this a go, and let's take a look at some of the results. The oil lamp is working out exactly as I'd hoped. It's acting as a reservoir, giving us an unlimited supply of dichloromethane to come up the wick, evaporate, take more heat with it, and create almost a permafrost on the top of the wick. What it's also doing, though, is taking a little bit of the soot from the previously burned wick, and it's carrying it along with the ice, so we're getting these interesting little black tips on the growing ice crystals. We saw that with the paintbrush a little bit as well. It was taking some of the brown paint that was on the brush before, carrying it with the ice. Usually at this point in one of our tutorial videos, you're probably expecting me to start plugging in some crazy coloured lighting arms into the AdaptLux Studio and experimenting with all the colours that we have available to us, trying out different things with our subject, and you're right, I would usually try that, but I don't think that this subject really calls for it. I think some nice white light works really well, but I do want to try out a little bit of blue. Now blue is a very cool colour and we have a very cool subject here. The ice I think is going to go really well with a cold wintry feel. To get that I'm going to add some blue via a couple of blue colour filters but also a blue lighting arm. I'm going to play around with these in the background of my shots, using them quite sparingly to try and get a little bit more atmosphere into my time lapses. I think one of the trickiest aspects of a shoot like this, and particularly with my setup, is choosing where to focus. It's really tricky to tell where these crystals are going to start growing and get an exact point of focus ready. What you generally have to do is a little bit of trial and error. Grow some crystals, change your focus a little bit, and then try again, hope that they turn up in the same place. Our little oil lamp frost candle makes it a little bit easier because generally the crystals are going to grow along the fibers of the end of the wick here. As you can see though, we're extremely close to the end of this this wick, so much that we can actually see each individual fiber. That means a very, very shallow depth of field. Usually I'd say you can compensate by closing your aperture all the way down and maybe doing some photo stacking. Because we're doing time-lapse videos though, we can't photo stack. I do have my aperture closed all the way down to f16. I could go a little bit further if I wanted to, but nothing, even f22, is going to give me a full wide depth of field enough to get all of this in focus. It's something that you're going to have to deal with a little bit and just choose strategically where to focus and find, hopefully, some nice frost crystals. I think this has been a pretty unique subject. I know it's not going to be for everyone, not everyone's going to have a big bottle of dichloromethane hanging around, but if you wanted to try something particularly unique, then you can go out and grab some of this pretty common solvent and try it out yourself using your own paintbrushes, or if you have an oil lamp like mine, definitely give that a go as well because it does give you a lot more time to work with. I've enjoyed shooting this stuff, but I want to know what you guys think to the results that I've got today and these nice time-lapse videos. Let me know down in the comments what you think to today's shoot, and if you enjoyed the video, give it a like whilst you're down there. Don't forget to subscribe for a lot more macro photography tutorials, ideas and inspiration coming in the future. And for now, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.